Next week marks the 50th anniversary of the break-in at Democratic National Party headquarters here in Washington. That event in 1972 would eventually trigger congressional hearings and bring down a U.S. president. The two reporters at the heart of uncovering what came to be known as the Watergate scandal have reissued their book, All the President's Men, this week with a new foreword, drawing parallels to the actions of former President Trump. On the eve of the first public hearings on January 6th, Bob Woodward and Carl Bernstein join us now. And we welcome both of you back to the NewsHour, Carl and Bob.
Thank you.
And Bob, I want to start with you. Over the years, thank you both, there have been many narratives about what Watergate was about. It's been called all of about a third-rate burglary, that the cover-up was worse than the crime. You've had plenty of time to reflect on it. What was it about?
Well, it was really an effort to destroy the process of nominating candidates for the Democratic Party. I mean, extraordinary. Nixon came along and said, gee, I'd like to run against this person, George McGovern, and he launched a covert campaign of espionage and sabotage and cover-up, and it worked. In the end, he got a weaker candidate, George McGovern, and he won 49 states. It was one of the great crimes of not just politics, but never seen anything like this until recently.
Yeah, and that's what I want to ask you about. As we think back, though, to President Nixon, Carl, one of the just enduring memories was from the Senate hearings, the late Senator Sam Ervin. And in one of those hearings, that famous moment when we heard the actual audio recording from inside the White House, would Richard Nixon have been brought down if that hadn't happened?
It was the so-called smoking gun tape. It's very possible he would not have been brought down. We don't know. It's if history. But it's very important to understand the progression from Richard Nixon's criminality to Donald Trump's criminality. They are both criminal presidents of the United States. But then Trump went further. He is the first seditious president in our history. How did that happen? He decided he would not abide by the election, the duly constituted free election of Joe Biden as the president of the United States, and staged a coup to keep Biden from taking office. The law calls for the election of the president of the United States to take place at 1 p.m. on January 6th. And there was a great effort, a conspiracy extending to the president to keep that 1 p.m. appointment from happening. And the object of all of this, including the demonstrations and breaking into the Capitol of the United States by the insurrectionists, was to keep this election of the president from happening so Trump could stay in office and Biden could not. But the idea of the president of the United States trying to stage a coup such as this is extraordinary, insidious, and we've never seen anything like it in our history.
And never seen anything like it. And yet, Bob, the two of you write in this new foreword about the parallels between the two. You write they were both insecure. You say paranoid. You say each viewed the world through the prism of hate.
Yes. I mean, there's so much hate in the politics of Nixon and of Trump. But what really struck us when you look at all of this, Trump is staking his claim now that the election was stolen. Well, he lost. He did not win. And Carl and I and Bob Costa, who I worked with on Peril, spent a lot of time looking for evidence to suggest or show that this was the 2020 election was fraudulent and stolen. There is zero evidence. It just doesn't pass the common sense test. But I agree with Carl. It really was sedition, a sedition action by Trump trying to overturn it. And he failed.
I mean,
now
that,
maybe he'll run again.
I mean, that word, you know, stops us cold. Carl, you used it a minute ago. You said seditious. Bob just said sedition. I mean, that is something that the two of you did not accuse Richard Nixon of. This is a different level.
It certainly is, because Richard Nixon resigned. He went to the South Lawn, got on a helicopter, and went into private life. Donald Trump was trying to attempt to not leave the White House, to continue illegally as the president of the United States. I think there's another really important thing to look at and consider here, that what made Nixon go were courageous Republicans.
When it comes to Republicans, Bob, being willing to stand up to President, there were a number who stood up to President Nixon. It's different today.
Well, in the end, all the Republicans stood up against Nixon, and Goldwater carried that message. But what's going to happen tomorrow night in these primetime hearings is, I think, a seminal moment, political moment, a teaching moment for the country. And even people who support Trump really ought to look at it, because they're making a case, and people may accept it or not, but they ought to listen. They may not like it, but it is critical that what I know about what's going to happen tomorrow night, a lot of it's going to be visual. A lot of it's going to be seen, right? The anger and the ugliness of breaking in to the capital of the United, unheard of action, not by 10 people, right, or 100, 1,000 people. Astonishing moment, and people ought to be cool about it and ponder it and look at this data and look at the violence. I couldn't believe that what was happening that day. Yeah. It was so out of the normal civility of American politics, the nonviolent tradition.
Well, we will see how many are watching. The country is much more divided politically even than it was back in the days of Richard Nixon. I think you already have answered this question. I'm going to finally ask the two of you, which of these two presidents posed a greater threat to our democracy, Carl Bernstein?
Trump, because he is willing to push things to the point where there can be no peaceful transfer of power, such as happens in the most authoritarian countries in the world. That goes farther than Richard Nixon.
But I think the answer is Trump, because he's thinking of running. I actually think he is going to run. I think he is going to be recruited by lots of moneyed Republicans, and he's going to say, look, the people are calling, I've got to run, and he's running again. And in the 4 years he held office, he learned in a somewhat haphazard way, but he learned where the levers of power are. And if he gets that power, the power of the presidency, the extraordinary concentration of power again, this country will never be the same.
Bob Woodward, Carl Bernstein, who broke the story of Watergate 50 years ago and who are here to watch what we're witnessing in 2022. Thank you both.
Thanks.
Thanks, Judy.